Leia here from leiaforsci.com, and in this video, we're going to look at how to create an MCAT study schedule. In a perfect world, you wake up, you have a relaxing morning routine, you sit down to study, you take a lunch break, you study some more, you go for a walk, you study some more, you relax for the evening, go to sleep, and tomorrow, do it all over again. Sounds a little too good to be true, right? What about school and work and family and all the other adult responsibilities that you have to accomplish? And say you did have all day to study. Ever sit down and say, I'm gonna get so much done today? And when the day is over, you think, where the heck did my time go? With ADHD, if I don't have a plan, my brain is all over the place and I get so overwhelmed with what it is that I have to do that I don't get much done without structure. Now, I'm not asking you to create a rigid plan where you have to stick to it exactly so that 5 minutes longer in the bathroom just derailed your entire day. No. Instead, I suggest having a template, a general guideline to follow throughout the day so that you know what you have to cover and when you have to do it, but even more important, so that you know that you have enough time for everything and have time to take a break and relax so that you don't burn out. Are you ready? Pause this video and grab a pen and paper. Go on, I'll wait. Put a line down the middle so that you have two columns, and then on one side put non-flexible commitments, on the other side flexible. Your non-flexible commitments are the things that have to happen at a specific time, and flexible commitments are things that have to happen, but you can put them wherever so long as they get done. Examples of non-flexible commitments include class, including time to commute, work, including time to commute, family responsibilities like dropping off and picking up the kids, personal and social commitments from shadowing, volunteering, a class you're taking at the gym, going to church, or anything that has a specific time. And if you're thinking, I have this commitment, but it's only for the next few weeks, or my semester ends in a few weeks, don't worry. You don't need to create a schedule for every single week. Instead, create a template for the season, and when things change drastically, just make a brand new template for whatever happens afterwards. Your flexible commitments will include chores like grocery shopping, meal prepping, cleaning, family responsibilities like helping the kids with homework and preparing their food, your own schoolwork and homework, and for this, try to overestimate the number of hours, because I would rather you have more time allocated to studying, finish early, and have bonus time than to allot too few hours, realize you need more study time, and now you're not sleeping, skipping the gym, or cutting into your downtime. Don't forget physical fitness like going to the gym, walking, hiking, taking a class, yoga. I cannot tell you how many times I see students forgetting to account for things like personal hygiene, taking a shower, waking up, you know, hitting snooze a couple of times, getting out of bed. You want to account for that so that it doesn't cut into your study time. The other thing is the time it takes to transition from A to B. For example, walking between your classes. If you just finished a class and now you want to study, you have to pack up your stuff, maybe go to the bathroom, walk over to the library, get settled, get your books out, leave time for that. And lunch. Yes, you need time to prepare your food, to eat your food, to clean up after, because I don't want you to fall into the trap where you don't have time to eat, so you skip your meal to study, then you're so hungry and you grab the nearest junk food, because that's not going to make you feel good, and that's going to impact your studying. Oh, and let's not forget personal time. Do not forget to take your breaks. Time to watch a movie, read a book, do your hobbies, some sanity time, date night. You know, the things that help you recharge and make you feel motivated to start studying again the next day rather than always, always going. Because if you burn out and you quit, you get nothing done. Now that you have your lists, let's see how to put it all together. Let's take a look at a few sample schedules. You can follow along and see even more examples in my MCAT Prep Guide Step 4,
which you can find on my website at leahforsci.com/step 4 or see the link below. The template I'm using is part of the companion workbook included with the guide, which you can download free at mcatstrategyguide.com/download or see the link below. Our first example is a student who is working Monday through Friday and taking a class on Saturday afternoon. This is based on a student I've worked with in the past, but with some modifications if I were to do her schedule again. You'll see the older version in the MCAT prep guide link below. Let's start with the non-flexible commitments, starting with work from 10 to 6:30 Monday through Friday, and her class from 1:30 to 4:30 on Saturday afternoon. Her other non-flexible commitment, which is easy to overlook, is the travel time that it takes to get to and from work, which in her case is 25 minutes.
Given that she has to leave her house around 9:30,
she chose to set her wake-up time during the week at 8 a.m. and 9 a.m. on the weekend to keep it somewhat consistent. In order to wake up at 8 a.m. and be fully functioning, her goal is to get to bed by midnight. Now, midnight may sound late, but don't forget, she has a later start to her day, and so that makes sense in her situation. Now that we have the non-flexible commitments, next we'll add the flexible commitments,
which in her case is going to the gym at least 3 times a week.
We have gym and dinner Tuesday and Thursday, and again on Saturday. That's it. The rest of her schedule is wide open for MCAT prep and schoolwork. Knowing that schoolwork is top priority, because she has to get an A in the class, we want to put her homework and review before we fill in the MCAT schedule. Making sure nothing is left for the last minute, we have a 3-hour block on Monday afternoon for biochem schoolwork, which, as you'll realize, gives her about an hour to come home, unwind, relax, eat, and get ready for her schoolwork. Additionally, we put a 3-hour block in the morning before her class, which will be used as prep and review time. This is not the time that she's going to study for upcoming quizzes or exams, because leaving things for the last minute is definitely not conducive to doing well. Instead, this 3-hour block is to review whatever she already did and studied on Monday, as well as watching videos and reading ahead for the upcoming lecture to make sure she's as prepared for class as possible and therefore never falling behind. Now that all of her requirements are scheduled, we want to add in the MCAT time, keeping in mind sanity, downtime, and making sure she doesn't burn out. So this is what we came up with.
On Tuesday and Thursday,
by the time she finishes work, gets home, goes to the gym, and eats dinner, she's pretty exhausted. Trying to force her mind to focus on something intense is just going to burn her out and probably not going to happen. So we settled on just 1 hour of cards practice. On Sunday, she'll start the day with her least favorite subject, and that is physics from 10 to 12:30. This ensures that she gets the worst one over with and doesn't dread studying for the rest of the day. This is followed by a 1-hour lunch break where she gets to relax and know that she got the worst subject over with. At 1:30, we give her a 2-hour block for MCAT organic chemistry, followed by another 1-hour break where she gets to relax, walk, do chores, whatever, and finish up with the last block from 4:30 to 6 for her favorite subject, psych-soch. Then, in realizing how tight the schedule is, let's go ahead and swap her second block of cars for biochemistry. Now wait a minute, why are we giving her a biochem block if she's taking a biochem class and has plenty of time to study? Studying for a class and studying for the MCAT is very different. So what we're doing here is giving her an hour a week to review from her MCAT books any topic that she's covered in class to make sure that she understands it well enough from the MCAT perspective in addition to what she's working on in her class. This gives us Wednesday and Friday afternoon for the last two subjects, Gen Chem and Biology, with a twist. Her block is from 8 to 11, but I'll have her go from 8 to 10 on the first subject, followed by a quick stretching break, followed by 45 minutes of bonus catch-up review until 11 p.m. This is the time when she gets to evaluate her progress for the week and see if every subject was moving at the pace that she wanted, And if she didn't get to a certain subject, because let's say she had an event on Sunday morning, or let's say she had to take her car to get fixed on Tuesday afternoon, she has the time to catch up so that subject wasn't completely lost from her schedule. What about Sunday after 6 p.m.? This is her night off. This is a chance to relax. Same thing for Saturday afternoon, where she gets some extra time to do chores so her apartment is not neglected. And that's it. The next schedule is one that I get asked about all the time. And this is if you have nothing but the MCAT to do day in and day out. This could be because you quit your job or took a semester off to study for the MCAT. Or this is what your schedule may look like when you're on winter break or summer break and the only commitment you have is the MCAT. Keep in mind this is a generic schedule and you want to customize it to your situation. The absolute first thing we're going to do before we even look at flexible and non-flexible commitments is take at least one day off, if not two. And the reason I recommend that is if you're studying for the MCAT around school, work, family, or other commitments, you don't have as much time, so you're trying to maximize it. But if the only commitment that you have is studying for the MCAT, you want to treat it like a full-time job and you don't want to burn out. You want to have at least one day, we'll use Sunday as an example, where you don't have to think about or worry about the MCAT. You get to take that day off guilt-free, knowing that tomorrow you're going to be refreshed, you're going to be recharged. This is not a waste of time, because this is going to leave you feeling motivated and energized when you start studying again the next day. The other recommendation I have is to find something to do for at least half a day a week, something like volunteering, shadowing, or getting out and about. If you're doing nothing but MCAT prep for weeks in a row, and you don't have anything in your schedule to break up the monotony, it's very easy to get burnt out, even with the time off. But taking at least half a day a week where you volunteer or shadow or do something that puts you in that medical field is going to have two benefits. One, it gets you out of the house. It takes your mind off the MCAT for just a few hours. But at the same time, it makes you motivated. It makes you excited when you realize, I'm in the medical field. This is what I'm studying for. This is why I'm working so hard. I randomly put it from 8 to 1 Thursday, but go with what you can. And let's go ahead and take another day off just to show you how possible it is. Now, just because you have a flexible schedule does not mean you can sleep in until 2 p.m. Commit to something reasonable, to get up at a reasonable time every day. For example, let's go with 9 a.m. If your alarm goes off at 9 a.m. and say you take an hour for your morning routine, Thursday would be 7 a.m. so you can get to volunteering in time. That hour should be enough time to wake up, go to the bathroom, prepare breakfast, eat, have some coffee, get ready for the day, so that by 10 o'clock, you're not figuring out what to study, you're not finding which books. By 10 o'clock, you're seated or at your standing desk, books open, videos open, ready to hit the ground running. I recommend starting with a 3.5 hour study block, which doesn't mean you're studying for 3.5 hours straight. It means your mind is in the zone for 3.5 hours, but you take short little breaks, as I explain in the Pomodoro technique linked below. This is followed by a 1 hour lunch break. Even if you have your food prepped, even if it doesn't take you that long, take the time off, get your mind out of whatever it is you just studied, relax, recover, so that you can feel refreshed and ready to dig into subject number 2 in the afternoon. Let's go with another 3.5 hour block from 2:30 till 6 p.m. Now that we have all the study blocks, let's fill them in, aiming to see every subject at least once a week. I like to put the harder subjects in the morning so that you're fresh, you dig in, and by lunchtime, it's done. It's over with. You know you've conquered the hardest part of the day. For most students, the hardest subject is physics, so let's put it on Monday when you're mentally fresh. Biochemistry and organic chemistry are two other toughies. Let's follow them by more enjoyable subjects, and obviously you want to customize it to what you find easy and difficult. We can follow physics with bio, biochemistry with gen chem, and orgo with psych soc. This leaves us 3 more blocks to play with. Here's what I recommend. Unless you're really good at physics, you probably need a second block for it. Now here's where we get a little creative. We want to include cars in the schedule, but I don't recommend a 3.5-hour block for cars, because after about 90 minutes, you get diminishing returns. So why not take your bio block or your psych-soc block and split it with cars as follows. What if you did 1 hour cars, then take a short 10 to 15 minute break, and finish up with bio? This gives you a shorter block for bio, which happens to be the biggest subject on the MCAT, so let's do the same thing on Thursday. 1 hour for cars, a 10 to 15 minute break, and then finish up with bio. We have every subject, but wait a minute, what about Friday afternoon? Let's make this the bonus catch-up block. Because let's face it, no matter how perfect your schedule, something might come up. And if you have to take your car in to get repaired on Wednesday morning and lost your Orga block, do it on Friday afternoon. If you were studying biochemistry but enzyme kinetics just didn't click and you feel like you'd benefit from seeing the material again, do it on Friday afternoon. So every week after lunch, ask yourself, which subject could benefit from a bonus block this week based on either something that happened during the week or something that was really difficult? And that is the subject you choose to do on Friday afternoon. You'll notice that every day ends with a 6 p.m. cutoff, and that was intentional. The rest of the evening is for working out, meal prep, relaxing, date night, friends night, whatever it is that you want to do without feeling deprived and without feeling guilty. On one condition, of course, that it doesn't take you too late into the night so that you sabotage your sleep and therefore sabotage the next day. Given that you're waking up 9 a.m., why not aim for a full night's sleep? Why not aim for a full 9 hours and aim to be in bed at midnight every night? That gives you a solid 6 hours to do whatever it is that you want and start over the next day. If you add it up, the studying comes to about 31.5 hours per week. I say about because 3.5 hours is more like 3 hours of studying plus breaks, which comes to less than 30 hours per week. Now, if this is your schedule during the winter holidays or summer break, I recommend not overdoing it so that you don't burn out. But if you feel like you need to maximize the time that you have and you want to add in more studying, here's a couple of ways to increase the hours. First is to take one of your days off and turn it into a study day, where you can copy the schedule that we have for during the week. This would add another 7 hours, and you can use that to double up on the other difficult subjects, perhaps a second block of biochem and a second block of orgo. The second option is to take a short break after your second study block and then add a no-pressure review or video block after dinner, for example, 8 to 10 p.m. The reason I say no pressure is that the average student, no matter how motivated they are, will be pretty tired by the end of the day, and trying to focus on something as intense as physics calculations or biochemistry pathways is going to feel burnt out. But if you know, for example, that tomorrow you're studying organic chemistry, why not use tonight to preview 2 hours of organic chemistry videos on the material that you're going to study tomorrow, but without the pressure of learning, memorizing, or taking notes, and rather using that time to get familiar with the concepts to make tomorrow's studying much easier. If you have physics on Friday morning, use Thursday night to watch the physics videos. You have Gen Chem Tuesday afternoon, maybe watch Gen Chem videos on Monday night, and so on. The key here is to customize it to your specific situation, because this is only a sample. For even more examples, including a student who has a packed college schedule that still allows time for MCAT studying, meal prep, and downtime, as well as what to do within the individual study blocks to make sure that you use your time effectively, check out step 4 of my Ultimate MCAT Prep Guide linked below, and then follow along with the schedule template in the companion workbook, which you'll also find below, or by visiting my website, mcatstrategyguide.com/download. The link again is mcatstrategyguide.com/download.